Kia ora koutou, welcome to this webinar on our Central Library Consultation event, Who Loves Our Libraries? This is one of three events which I'm just going to talk about in just a moment. I'm Mayor Andy Foster. I'll be emceeing the conversation tonight. We have, as I said, three events. This one is entitled Who Loves Our Libraries? And we have three esteemed panelists here who are going to give us their perspectives from different parts of our community. First of all, we have a korero from Sandra McCullum, who is the Interim General Manager of Changemakers Resettlement Forum. Sandra has a long background in education, including 15 years as Principal of Mount Cook School. Secondly, we have Claire Mabey, who is the Director of Verb Wellington, which of course is a popular festival in our arts and culture capital. And then finally, we have Ella Flavelle, who is the Chair of the Wellington City Youth Council, who will all be speaking to us. Just before I ask Sandra to speak, in terms of the housekeeping, everyone watching is on mute. So if you have a question, please use the questions box. We will be recording the webinar and a link will be emailed to you afterwards. So the questions will come through to our support team and they will then furnish them to me, and then I'll ask them of our panelists. The other two events that we've got coming up are this one's, as I said, is about who loves our libraries. So it's about the range of people who love using our library service. The second one is entitled Spaces for Everyone. That will be from 6 o'clock until 7 o'clock Monday evening. And that really is about the future, a future-focused library. And we're starting to see what a future-focused library might look like with the opening of Waitohi in Johnsonville. And so that will give us some interesting perspective there. And finally, on Wednesday, from 12 until 1 o'clock, 12 midday until 1 o'clock, we have an engineering focus, because this is both about building and about service. And if I can finally, before passing to Sandra, just remind you that submissions on this consultation close on Monday the 7th, and so we look forward to hearing from you. Council is very much open-minded as to what the best solution is. We know that there's going to be a wide diversity of views in our community. It's going to be a very big decision whatever we make. We know we're not going to please everybody regardless of what we do, but that's what we're here to do, and to make some decisions. But we do really want your feedback. We want your thinking, and we want to understand why you're thinking what you're thinking, so that that will help us to make as best decisions we possibly can for our city going forward. So with that, Sandra, second time round.
Kia ora anō. It feels like take two. Yes, I'm the General Manager for Changemakers, and the Changemakers is about ensuring that people from refugee backgrounds have every right in the world to flourish here in Wellington, Aotearoa, in every context. So I think this is a great opportunity, the context being the Central Library, to talk about, you know, the role of the library for our refugee and migrant communities. And I started off with, over the last few days, contacting people and saying, you know, talk to me about the library, and, you know, what does it mean to you? What is its purpose for you? And one of there are three or four key themes that came out. And the first one that came out from everybody was about the importance of belonging, around feeling welcome and included and connected. And for our, you know, refugee background and migrant communities, that is just so important in every aspect of their lives in Aotearoa. The other thing that people said was about resourcing, and both the people resource and the resources of the library. And people feel as though it's a right, they have a right to be there, and it's even greater when they can see themselves in the library. They can walk in and see people from their own cultures, hear the languages spoken, you know, from their mother tongues, and also that the resources that are available reflect such diverse communities. And it's about participating and contributing and learning. And one of the conversations that quite a few raised was many of them are great users of the Newtown Library. And I said, well, you know, what's that all about? That, you know, what's so compelling about the Newtown Library? And they talked about it was often just an excuse not even to go and get books, but to connect with each other, connect with people from other cultures, to engage in activities with their whānau, as well as feel part of something. And the Newtown Library clearly has created such an atmosphere, which, you know, a lot of them talked about would be just great to be replicated in the Central Library. And so, you know, pulling out the bigger themes from the conversations I had, you know, the key components of a reimagined Wellington Central Library, it's about people, places and platforms coming together as a knowledge institution. It's about a place for equitable lifelong learning and a trusted hub. It's about a place that nurtures new thinking and relationships. And I think that a library also inspires learning and the growth of social capital. And with all of those things, while it's, you know, it's fine to talk about those, if people don't feel right at the, in terms of, you know, when they get to the door of the place, well, then we're not, it's not going to achieve all those really, really important things. And I think that this is an incredible opportunity for getting it right for, you know, over the next 20, 30, 40 years, the population of Wellington will become increasingly diverse, and we've just got such a great opportunity to celebrate in our Central Library the diversity of our population.
Thank you, Sandra. I'm going to pass on over to Claire.
Thank you. Kia ora tātou. I'm from Verb Wellington, which is an organisation that runs events with writers and readers throughout the year, and we have a festival every year. We started life as Lit Crawl, which started in 2014, and the kaupapa was to create a writers' festival that was democratic and that would reflect Wellington's incredibly vibrant literary culture, which is always being refreshed by emerging writers and new independent publishers. And we have a kind of a world-class literary culture in the city. And the Central Library was one of our first Lit Crawl venues. So we have amazing memories of those events where they would get so full that people would go all the way up the staircase and watch from the platforms on the stairwell. So it was a very special collaboration to be able to run events after hours in the Central Library. And we've always had a very close relationship with the library's network and the librarians as well, when we've run all sorts of events in the Central Library and also in the suburban libraries as well. For us, as well as the event work to connect people in the city and out-of-town visitors as well with stories and with conversation, there's also the marketing network of the libraries, and particularly Central Library, because it's such an incredible way for people to access information about art as well as art itself. We've done installations in the libraries before, and we know lots of other artists who've used the libraries as an art space in lots of different ways. So for us, the library is an essential part of the literary ecosystem that we're in. So that really is the connection between a writer and their work and the dissemination of their work. So the real heart of the library for us is that repository of our stories, and how important it is that everybody in New Zealand has a really and democratic access to those things. So I guess I read an article recently about how libraries really are one of the last democratic spaces in a city, because they fill so many essential functions. And then coming back to Verb and our structure and the way we operate, we're an independent arts company. So that really means that we operate on a project basis. We a lot of what we do is free for the public or very heavily subsidised by funding. So there's a whole bunch of independent artists operating in Pōneke and across New Zealand, but Wellington traditionally has often been seen as a city where independent artists thrive. And I think the access to affordable spaces to meet and to make and to present work is a really crucial part of the survival of the independent artist, which is on has always been a precarious way to live, but is quite challenging as the world changes, and in particular on COVID. So for us, the library has always been a place where we've held meetings. I've got lots of memories from Clark's Cafe, meeting writers there or collaborative partners there or and librarians there to work on our events. And it's also a place where lots of artists and writers and producers and directors like me work. So the loss of that space is very significant in terms of the independent arts community having a free and comfortable and welcoming space to work. In the arts context, the library networks are essential. And I think it's really exciting to be thinking about the Central Library and what that future space might mean for the arts community in Wellington. Mm.
Claire, thank you very much for that. Just before I go to Ella, if you've got questions as the presentations are made, feel free to start putting them into the box that you've got, the questions box you've got on your screen, and that'll give us a good place to start from when Ella has done her presentation. So Ella, welcome.
Awesome. Kia ora tātou, ko Ella Toku Ingoa. I'm the current chair of the Wellington City Youth Council, which is an advisory group to the City Council, with the goal of making Wellington the best it can be for young people within the city. So we've had some preliminary discussions around our views on the future of the Central Library. And what's really come out is that it is a hub for rangatahi within the city to convene for free without having to, let's say, purchase a coffee to go and meet up and to study and also to learn. So our view for the future of the Central Library is that we really have to be bold in our design and ensure that we are putting our diverse community at the centre of our decisions. And providing spaces for everyone going into the future. So not providing a space that's necessarily static, a space that can bend and flex with the different needs that it sort of is brought to them. And so another main thing that Youth Council has brought up is that we needed a central youth space in the city for young people to be able to just walk in and sit down for free, and that's warm. And that is sort of like a hub for young people to be able to take a look at opportunities around the city and meet up with the other young people and really have just a safe space to hang out and let's say have meetings for lots of volunteering opportunities around the city. So one of the main things I used the city library for was volunteering. So when I was a member of different organisations, let's say TEDx Youth Te Aro was one of them, we used the City Library as our meeting space for free. It was warm, it was open, and the loss of that has sort of led us to have to find, you know, friends who are working or students at Victoria University of Wellington, which not everyone will have access to. So we really are focused on having spaces like that for young people around the city. Apart from that, we also see that it's not just about books, having a space that bends with time, so having computers, Wi-Fi available, AV equipment, because that can be very expensive and not very accessible for many rangatahi, having 3D printers, all of these newfangled technologies that are usually very inaccessible to the majority of the population. We think that's really important to have available in a public space for learning and to maximise people's potential. Also having an exhibition space. So taking a look at Tūranga or Waitohi, the two new libraries, one was in Johnsonville and the other's in Christchurch, and getting some learnings from them about how to create a modern, light, flexible space that allows for as much potential as possible going into the future. So that's Youth Council's priority when we're going into consultation on the Central Library.
Thank you. Thanks, Ellen.
Do we have any questions that have come through just yet?
Not as yet.
Okay, well, look, I'm going to thank you, so Sandra, Claire and Ella for those comments. And what was pretty interesting is that there was a lot there which wasn't about books. It's not just about books, but it's about a whole lot of other things. And I thought that was really interesting that you, Sandra, I mean, you talked about those sort of, you know, sort of attributes of belonging, being connected, flourishing, inclusiveness, diversity. I think that was really, really powerful. Claire, you talked about being welcoming. And I think, and Ella, you talked about, you know, that flexibility and those sort of characteristics, of, you know. So it was really, I almost barely think any of you actually mentioned books, but I'm sure that they're there. Yeah. Okay, so a couple of questions to kick us off until our audience put some questions in front of you. First one is, how do you see the future Central Library supporting the growth of the city, particularly within the inner city? So as we have more people living in Wellington, what does that mean for our Central Library? Who's going to kick us off?
I'll go first. I think I'll just speak from an arts perspective, I think, because that's what I know best. But I think one challenge in Wellington, as the mayor will know well, is event space. So I think a library that has flexible event space would be really exciting and necessary for the city. I think there's a lot of really amazing things that can happen when it's quite rare for one building to fulfill so many functions. And I think that is such a gift for a city, because it means that so many different audiences and cross-sections of a community can come together. And that's what libraries do just by being themselves. So I think having an event space within that context is also a very rare thing. So, and the reason I say that is in the arts, what an artist or a writer can talk about is kind of infinite in its possibility. So there's incredible diversity already existing in what artists produce for people. And then the trick is to get the audience to come and engage with that work. And sometimes our traditional spaces can be difficult because they come with a context that can appear to be unfriendly or for a certain type of person. So I think the library, the democratic nature of a library works very well for a democratic audience and for the arts. So I think an event space is really crucial, and I think very much needed in Wellington. And I think we've already seen examples of that in Tauranga. I've actually used Tauranga as an event space, and it's a real asset to the city. So I would be excited if that was part of the future library. And then kind of related to that, I think speaking really from the literary world and richness of Wellington, I think it would be interesting as a concept to think about what a writer centre or a particular space for the art of writing might look like in a library. I think that's an interesting concept to be fleshed out in detail, but I think it's an interesting idea and something that we haven't really had in Wellington ever, to my knowledge.
Can you just sort of expand on that a little bit? What does that mean by sort of writer centre?
Writer centres have lots of different iterations around the world. They're quite well embedded in lots of cities, particularly in Australia or in Europe and the UK. But they're places that are very generative and support writers to work, but also to people to interact with their work. And they might be a space, for example, where a residency is held. So it could be that a library becomes a space where you can have a writer's residency, which are always sorely needed. People need time to write. And in a city like Wellington, I think that not only would it be interesting for the city and people in the city, but it'd be interesting for people outside of the city as well to see that Wellington had opportunities where writers could make work. And I think residencies a real gift that a space can offer, and they're not that hard to achieve either. So I think that could be part. I think all writer centres are quite organic and bespoke, so it would be interesting to see what people would think about what that might be like. But I think essentially it's a dedicated space that supports that art form. Yeah.
Thanks, Claire. It feels like there's things which this is going to evolve, and there's going to be some details and some granularity about whatever the aspirations are. And so on that note, Ella, I mean, you said that a space that is flexible needs a central youth space. Can you just expand on that a little bit about what that actually means?
Yeah.
What kind of thing you see envisaged there?
Absolutely. So something we've heard reoccurringly from young people is that in the absence of Reading cinemas, which used to be a space where young people just walked in, sat down for free and just chilled out, and the closure of the central library has really led to them not really having a space that they can just go out and chill, especially in winter. I think that's hit a lot of young people really hard. And it's not bringing them necessarily into the central city anymore, because there isn't really a space they can just go. So the importance of having a space that is accessible, so potentially on the ground floor, or at least in a space that young people can see and don't have to really go through too many hoops to get into, is incredibly important for young people to feel safe and connect with one another. And there are heaps of opportunities that come with a space like that. So you can post opportunities, have a central hub, even have youth workers in there just casually chatting to young people, events, workshops, you name it. There's so much potential, and even just having that availability of that space is really important. Also making it interactive, so ensuring that there's something, an exciting elements to it. So when I go down to the new library to Aue, I like the little pods that I see that young people can sit in. So really innovative design brings young people in and gets them excited, I think.
So a place people can just be together.
Absolutely,
Sandra, I'll go back to the original question I had about, you know, the growth of the city, but you might want to comment on the kind of spaces that you might want to see in there as well.
Yeah, and it's interesting because I was thinking when the Central Library was open, and I was at Mount Cook School, our tamariki used to go, every class went once a week to the City Library, and you know, they'd have this amazing session with the librarian. But what happened as a result of that was they then took their parents on the weekend because, you know, they had a great experience of it. And I was thinking, in terms of, Claire, what you were talking about around the notion of writing and having a writer's centre, also providing an opportunity for, those communities to be able to tell their stories and be involved in that. And another comment that one of the people I talked to made about the Newtown Library was she took her children there for activities, and one day she went, a member of her community was encouraged by the librarian to read to the children who were there. And so the comment that was made about that was, you know, that mother was modelling to her children and to other children. She was modelling to the rest of the people in the library, and just the opportunities that were created that are much harder to access if you're from a, especially from a refugee background. Yeah. So just drawing people in and, you know, having multiple opportunities for being, you know, feeling as though they've got something to contribute and learn from.
Yeah, cool. Okay, now we've got a great question here from somebody in the audience. How can our central library strengthen and promote our collective identity as a city and reflect the people who live here? Who's going to start us off with that one? Do you want me to read it again?
Yes.
Yeah. How, there's a lot in there. How can our central library strengthen and promote our collective identity as a city and reflect the people who live here?
I think to start off, consulting, obviously this is what's happening now, which is really fantastic, is getting an idea of what different communities want and need. And providing a space that is flexible so that, I mean, you obviously can't provide for everything within one space, but having the ability to when needed is incredibly important. And also thinking about the diversity of people in Wellington as a changing city, almost forecasting that, ensuring that you are providing spaces specific to different cultures, and it isn't just a very Pākehā-centred space. So everyone feels welcome, feels like this is their space, and they can take ownership of it. In terms of a young person's perspective, absolutely providing technology is always very important, and a collection of books, which we already have a fantastic collection, centred on young people and what they're interested in, because it is a place of learning and it should be accessible to everyone.
Cool, thanks Ella.
And the collective identity, it's interesting, will change, but it would also be really interesting to have an evolving understanding and conversation around, you know, what that what is our collective identity as a city, and you know, who defines it, because I think that's, you know, in a way, I think that would be just such a such an interesting but also really visionary way of looking at thinking about the central library.
Yeah, I agree. I think, well, consultation is the first thing. It's just actually getting an understanding that is broad and also meaningful, what people need and want, and allowing that conversation to be as ambitious as possible, I think, at this point in time in particular. And then I think it's exactly what Ella has said, it's not a static thing, and it's going to change, and having the ability to be adaptable and refresh that idea of a collective identity is going to be key. And I think that's so much about the design of the library is so crucial, I think. And I can imagine that will be an incredibly intensive process.
Yeah.
And having lots of different voices around that table as well.
So I think that whatever decision that we make ultimately on, you know, this is the building, there's a whole lot to go on inside. It's not just, you know, the building is a frame, whether it's the existing one or the or a new one, and it's a frame for a whole lot of things that go on inside there. So there's a power of work still to be done to design what goes in. Yeah. Even if it's existing building, the existing layout is a layout which is, you know, was designed in the 1980s, and you know, life is quite different now.
Yeah, and it's around the collective kaupapa of the library. You know, that's really having a really strong kaupapa. And the thing around the consultation, because I hate that word consultation, because it's quite white middle class, but the conversations will need to be done in a whole lot of different ways so that you get that really, really, you know, collective across community voice.
Consultation is a bit directional, one way then back the other way, isn't it, as opposed to engagement, which is a conversation. Okay.
Great question.
Right.
Yeah.
There's another really good question come through. If you're in a space / library that makes you happy, what would you see here? And who else are you seeing here?
Well, that's a great question.
I like it.
I'd start with saying it's a light space. So it's, you know, it's flexible, it's open. There is sunlight. There are plants potentially, or it's a green space available or accessible. And who am I seeing in the space? Everyone, I guess, making sure that it's a space that everyone feels welcome in is really important, and opening your eyes to, you know, the great community that is Wellington is definitely something that would be important to me. Obviously seeing other young people as well, making use of the space, and even having spaces for different sort of activities. So I know for young people studying, I definitely found the Central Library a great place to study, because they had the different tiers of you could speak in this level, you couldn't speak in this level. So having it catering to the different needs of everyone. Mm. Yeah.
So all of that speaks to diversity of needs, diversity of people.
Mm. Absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Claire or Sandra, do you want to have a thought?
I feel the same. I would want to see everyone, and I think that's why a library is so special. It's because it's what you expect to see, I think. Mm. And I would love an event space. I'd love to walk in and be able to either hold myself or go in to see an event, a conversation event, that really celebrates kind of what that library and context, what that library means and supports. I think the cafe was a really amazing part of Central Library. I don't know how other people felt, but I think having that, manaki of food and coffee within the building was really important. And I think it kind of completed a cycle of quiet time into being able to easily go and feed yourself or meet someone. It's interesting. I kind of often think the basics of human life are kind of other people, stories, food.
Yeah.
So I think
in that order.
You're
gonna be very hungry.
I don't know, it's very chicken and egg. But I think those things are the key elements.
I think Clark's is certainly that's become the we wouldn't do a library now, a new one, I think, without copying cake, so to speak.
Yeah.
Sandra, do you want to comment there?
And I just think you're adding on around seeing everyone there, and in order to see everyone there from across backgrounds, having activities that are going to draw people, draw that whole range of people in. I think that could be so exciting. I mean, imagine if you walked in, every day and saw just a cross section of our, amazing Wellington population.
Pretty consistent message.
Yeah.
Good. Okay, another question coming in, and our audience is growing.
Oh, great. We've
grown by considerable proportion. How does the library enable learning, particularly lifelong learning, or for those that are new to our country? Well, I guess that's probably, we should really start with you this, Sandra, shouldn't we?
Can you read it again, please?
How does the library enable learning, particularly lifelong learning, or for those who are new to our country?
Oh, that's a really good question. It provides opportunities. The first thing that I'll say again, it provides a welcoming space where people, if we're talking about people from other countries who walk in and feel as though they belong, and that, that again is about who's there and the way you walk in the door what you see when you walk in. And then I think it provides that there's such a lot of room to create opportunities for people to be learning or have people to help facilitate, what they want to access in terms of resources, and also in terms of again, opportunities. I think again of the notion of a place for study for one of the things that for our refugee background young people, having a place where they meet and talk. For our people who are new to the country, getting more, understanding more about the culture of our city and living. And again, it comes back to that whole notion about, what are we there for? And when you walk in the door and you're greeted by somebody, how does that feel? And it's interesting, I was just thinking about that notion of connection, because I live in Miramar, and so, apart from when I request most of the time, but it just occurred to me the other day when I went in, I found my books that I'd requested on the shelf, I got my card out, I went to the electronic machine, and I walked out without having any interaction with the librarian. Now, that doesn't mean to say I can't, but I remember as a kid when I started going to the library, you go in and you talk with the librarian about what you were reading. And in a way, I think that's part of making a library a welcoming space. And not just in terms of accessing and talking about your, the resources, but that sense of being able to have a conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, cool. Ella or Claire, do you want to add to that? Do you need me to repeat the question?
No, I think I remember. I think I guess I was thinking about the books in this context actually, and just having like a very well curated and collection that serves multiple languages and cultures. And I'm speaking very ignorantly on this subject, but because I imagine this is done already, but that collection is actually created in consultation with communities who might want to access books. So I think that is important from the book angle. That's all I really have to add to that.
I completely touch off of what's been said so far. In terms of the lifelong learning, having access to resources that you might not have access to at home is really important, because lots of this new technology and certain books can be very expensive and not something that people necessarily want to have as their own or can't have as their own. Mm. So having readily accessible technology such as the 3D printers at Waitohi allows people to really just branch out and create things that they might not have already had the opportunity to. And even, you know, potential how-tos, so little lessons on how to use this sort of stuff is really important, I think. Because you can't just go in and get the hang of it instantly. Mm. You've got to have that learning there. And I think that opens up so many opportunities for useful things for Wellington to sort of give back, you know, creating new artists if there's AV equipment and they haven't been able to access that before. I think that's really important to have as well. And obviously a very well curated and ever-evolving collection of books as well.
Thanks, Emma. Okay, look, we've got time for one more question, and then we've got some, there'll be some wrap-up comments that I've got to make and then ask you for your sort of final thoughts for this session. The last question we've got there is, what could some of the barriers be to accessing or using our libraries? And what could the Central Library be or do to reduce those barriers? Who's going to kick us off?
Ooh, I think there is a risk of people, let's say, not feeling safe in the environment or the building itself not being accessible, which I'm sure will be taken into account.
Physically,
stairs, barriers in that way, not having spaces where certain people can sit down. Definitely, I think, providing a space that caters to all of that. And I'm sure that'll be in the engagement regarding the Central Library. Apart from that, you're just ensuring it's safe and light, and there are people to talk to if you have an issue and there is, you know, someone there looking out for you at all times when it's open.
Are there any particular things that would sort of, you'd say, well, that might not feel safe? What were kind of safety sort of issues that you're thinking of?
Yeah, so particularly, you know, spaces where people might be yelled at by other people. I know when I've been studying there with friends, you know, you might get a grumpy person come up and be like, please shut up, which is fine, but it's always nice to be able to talk to a librarian and, you know, have that conversation with another adult or another young person in the area. So just little things like that. There'll always be little interactions like that within the library.
So do you think places which feel like this is a place that you can be noisy in other places? Do you have some room?
Yeah, absolutely. And respecting those rules as well and being held accountable to them. So obviously having someone come around and politely tap you on the shoulder and be like, okay, can you move to a speaking space if you're over there? And also having the ability to eat food in certain parts of the library. I always loved the cafe. That was a place I remember from when I was a little baby. But definitely having a space where you can work and also eat inside.
Yeah, that's interesting, your comment about the baby. I think when I first had my son and was still working when he was very little, we used to slip him around to meetings all the time, and so spent a lot of time in Clark's Cafe sleeping while we met there. And it was actually, it's interesting, I hadn't really thought about that, but it was one of the spaces in the city we always felt comfortable bringing a baby, and knowing that there was a space to be a parent there no matter how loud your child might be. So that's an interesting thing. I think the libraries do that really well, is provide places for young families. I think what's interesting about a space like that closing so suddenly and then being unavailable for such a long time, the reopening will actually be really important, because the habit of going there was 3,000 people a day, I think. That will be interesting to reignite in people. And I think that whatever form that kind of reopening and re-welcoming people in probably needs to be done in a lot of different ways for all the sorts of people that use the library. So I think that's an interesting thing to think about.
And I just think about attitudes to people, and I'm going to talk about our communities who don't have white skin, and attitudes from staff, and I just hear on a daily basis, and in a way it's quite timely, you know, with what's gone on in Christchurch and the significance of that week, but I hear on a daily basis from community members just the way they are often treated in the supermarkets, through government agencies, and just that really subtle attitude about you're not really as good as us, and, you know, what are you doing here? And I think that is fundamental to that sense of walking into the space and being, you know, feeling you're part of it. Yeah. Mm.
Oh, look, well, thank you, all of you, for those answers. I'm looking at the time, and of course we had a slightly false start at the beginning. We had to double take with the sound not working for a while. So look, the time is almost up. We're going to have a few sort of wrap up comments in just a moment. Sandra, Ella, Claire, thank you so much for your participation tonight. And for celebrating all the things that we love about our central library, and all the things that we can aspire to love about a new central library, however it is, you know, whatever building it's in, and however it's imagined. But I think we've seen the way of the future. I think, you know, I was quite excited when I went down and saw Christchurch's Tauranga Library, and then the thinking of that could be part of what we do with Waitohi. And I think, you know, in those two, we see the library of the future. And so this is our opportunity to create our central library of the future. So thank you too to our audience for being here. And this, of course, is going to be able to be picked up again on the website if people want to see it later on. But just before we finish, I will also note that the further two seminars that we've got coming up in just a moment. But if you've got any wrap-up comments, anybody would like to add anything?
Just great opportunity to be bold and visionary and aspirational.
Cool. Ka pai.
I'd say kia ora for coming. Thank you so much. Definitely submit, have your say. This is our opportunity to really create a sustainable, long-term library that can continue to serve us for decades to come. So let's be bold.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think submitting is really important. So there's lots and lots of different voices feeding into the thinking. I think that we should be aspiring to be the library that our city needs, not what other cities have necessarily done. While they provide great examples, I think that this is a Wellington library for Wellington people. And I think it should be ambitious as possible.
So look, thank you all very much. And thank you to you, our audience, our audience tonight, and our audience for anybody else who will view this later on. I do encourage you, as our panelists have, to make submissions. Just talk about it with your friends as well. Talk about it with your family. Because one of the great things in all these conversations, and I think, Sandra, you mentioned, you know, you don't like the word consultation particularly. I agree. I mean, these should be conversations that we don't enter into. It's not a I say, you respond, and I listen. It's a conversation that's ongoing, and we develop our thoughts as we go along by listening to each other. And I think that's really, really important. So I encourage you to listen to each other, to have those conversations, and then to provide us with your thoughts. The submission period closes on Monday the 7th, and then we've obviously got a lot of thinking to do at this stage,
And obviously there's more thinking to be done. We, you know, we've had several of the comments made tonight, which have been about what goes inside the building, whether it's new or the existing building, you know, and that's going to be a big piece of work, and a lot of conversation, a lot of thought will go into that, as I know it did for Waitohi. And so thank you again to you, our audience. And just finally to remind you that we have two more seminars coming on Monday from 6 until 7. And that is about spaces for everyone. We have, again, a great lineup of speakers there. And I think this is very much the thinking about the library of the future. And it's interesting, actually, one of the speakers there we have is the manager of Tauranga Library and chair-elect of the Public Libraries New Zealand. So I think that'll be really interesting. And then the third in the series is on Wednesday from 12 until 1. And that involves looking at the engineering side of things. And I think, again, that'll be really fascinating. So I do encourage you to participate in both of those webinars. And again, thank you to all of you, Sandra, Ella, Claire, for tonight, and to all of our audience.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Kia ora. Thank you.